I love television. My wife will tell you. I binge watch television. To binge television means you just watch it 18 hours straight. If I could, I would. I tell people that the flu wasn't that bad for me. I got the chance to just watch television all day. I got Netflix, I got Hulu, I got Amazon Prime, I got the rest of those things, and I got cable. I'm starting to see why do I still have cable. I be thinking about that sometimes. I got Netflix on my phone. At my job, they were complaining because it's always somebody gonna complain and mess something up. And we had to change our office hours, and so I was kind of getting away with not having an office hours. And our boss told them, it's gonna change, but right now, y'all go ahead and y'all do what you gotta do. And it changed this year. People were like, oh, I can't do this, I can't do that. I said, I'm just gonna have more time to watch Netflix. Just being real. That's gonna be real, right? Y'all got some stuff that y'all do too. I'm a television person. But God began to put in my heart, he said, Daniel, how much time do I get? Because some of us right now, we're looking at the clock. He should be preaching by now. He should be through by now. He ain't got to the word yet. Because we get so antsy around these things. But like I'm telling you, me and my wife, we have some series that we like, man, we'll be sitting like, it'll be 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. Give me my phone off. It's my phone off. Go to bed. That is me now. Everybody got something they do. It'll be 11 o'clock, really like, well, I ain't really got to get up to around 6. And I'm like, well, baby, I got to get up to around 6 either. Let's go ahead and watch one more. Amen. And I think sometimes when we come to church, how antsy are we sometimes? Right. When it comes out of reading our word, how antsy are we? How anxious are we to move on to something else sometimes? And that's human nature. But you know what? That's discipline right there, too. You know who you bless? You bless that disciplined child, don't you? That one that you tell them, look, here's $20, go to the store and buy me some stuff in my chain bag. Or you like, my mama, she give you 20, but it really gonna cost about 28. You know, you don't charge mama, you know. You just go ahead. But then you got some, they'll buy half of what you said and keep that money themselves. And God began to put on my heart, he said, I gave you 24 hours a day. How much you give it to me, how much you keep it for yourself. That's good. That's good. If you don't mind, let us stand right now. We're going to the book of Genesis, the 8th chapter, the 20th verse. Do give honor to God and give honor to my pastor, Apostle C.J. Baker. Look, next week, guys, pick a room. If we all can go, I want everybody that can go to go. This might be the last church anniversary, in Picayune. It might be transitioning pretty soon, so if you can go, please go. The van should be leaving out around 2, so we can be down at about 4 o'clock. Amen? Amen. Give an honor to Elder Sims, Evangelist Brown, Sister Minister Gilmore, all the deacons, saints, and friends, everyone's and everyone's. Amen? All right, Genesis 8 and 20 says, and Noah built an altar unto the Lord, and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl, and offered burnt offerings on an altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor. And the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake. He said, I'm not going to curse it because of what man did. For the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. All the things that be so good. God said, your imagination was messed up from the time you was a child. Neither will I again smite any more every living thing as I have done, while the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. Today we're going to talk about being responsible to time. Being responsible to time. Let us pray. If any man speak, let him speak of the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. So let me go ahead and make sure I don't talk too long, because I'm talking about time today. I don't want to be timely. So there are few things more precious than time. Somebody say time. Somebody say time again. Time. Somebody say time again. Time. I want you to think about that. Think about time. All of us are given time, and none of us know how much we have. I don't know how much I have. I'm believing God. We make plans for tomorrow, not even know if we're going to make it to tomorrow. I've already made plans for tomorrow. I got plans for next week. I got plans for next month. We're planning a Transformers Conference, amen, in March. God bless you. Somebody give God's praise for that. We're planning that. But we don't know how much time we have, do we? You see, none of us know how much time anybody else has. We do this. However, if we walk with God and we hear his voice, we will know what we should do with the time that we've been given. It is a tragedy that we are so prone to waste a commodity as precious as time. Don't we waste it sometimes? You see, yet it happens so often. I am tormented by the wasted time in my life that I cannot have back. I'm tormented by that. I'm tormented by the fact that I wasted some time that's out of my life. Have you wasted time with certain people you shouldn't have been with? Have you wasted time in certain places you shouldn't have been? Amen. You just waste time. I'm still tormented by the fact that I used to be addicted to NFL Madden, to some EA Madden, amen? Madden football. I was addicted to that. I was addicted to playing the college football game on PlayStation. My wife would tell you, I spent the whole Saturday playing video games. That's been years ago now, years ago. I said, Lord, if I could get that time back, how many books I could have written in that time? How much I could have gotten done with that time? I'm tormented by that. And all of us are required to be responsible to the time that we are given. See, God has assigned a time to everything that we have on earth. Ecclesiastes 3:1, we quote it all the time. I want you to see it. It says, to everything there is a season and a time. Somebody say time. To every purpose under the heaven. Everything and every purpose has been given a time. We would do well to understand that everything we go through and everything that exists has been given a time from God. Amen. Where you are right now, you have a time limit on it. What you're going through is a time limit on it. Everything has been given a time limit from God. You will have times of joy and you will have times of sorrow. You're going to have times to prosper and times to save. I didn't say time to be broke. I believe we got to save what we had when we were born. Y'all didn't hear that. I want a pastor to say, I got time to be broke. No. And God says, you save that which you prosper. Amen? You got time to save. You will have time. You have time for everything that God has purposed in your life. You just don't know how much you have for every purpose. And so people tend to have a hard time moving from one time to another. I'm going to preach to y'all in a minute. Sometimes we have a problem moving from one time to another. See, it seems as though as soon as you get used to this season, I'm going to preach to me, another one comes. As soon as you get used to what's going on right now, God's going to transition you to something else. And we find ourselves sometimes trying to hold on to a season that passed us by. I'm being real inside the house. As soon as I got used to what God is doing right now, he's moving me to something bigger and something greater. And there are few things more pathetic than trying to operate today with yesterday's mentality. Few things that are crazier than that. You see, my son, you know, my son is young and he's into the gospel rappers, and sometimes, yeah, I catch him, he listens to other rap sometimes too. Just being real in the house, your kids are doing it too probably. And so I catch him and I'm like, son, what is up with these things? And I say, this is age coming in. I believe I grew up in the golden era of hip hop. Late 90s hip hop, Jay-Z, DMX, Nas, the real lyricists. Now they got Lil Uzi Vert and Lil Yachty and these people that look just crazy. And they rap crazy to me. It's all weird to me. And they rap crazy, they act crazy, they dress funny to me. And I said, Lord, but my music, of course, that's how old I am. My music was a lot better than their music. We had real hip hop, they got some crazy stuff. You know what God told me? They ain't rapping to you. These rappers right now are not rapping to 35-year-old college instructors. They are rapping to 18-year-olds. And so you're going to look old if you're trying to begin to criticize what's going on now because you still think, oh, I ain't preaching y'all. Isn't that interesting that we criticize the move now because it was never meant for us?
That's real.
I'm going to preach to y'all. And that's pathetic. And so my son's looking at me because to him, Lil Yachty is bigger than Jay-Z. To him, little Uzi Vert, the rest of these guys are big guys. He's saying no, so maybe they're the ones he likes, but I got to do the one I heard of. And so, but for me to begin to say, that's not good, that's not this, that's not that, I'm still operating in yesterday. Oh, can I come to the church? There are people that love yesterday so much, they can never enjoy or appreciate today. We love yesterday. See, in Autopsy of a Deceased Church, y'all can buy that by Tom S. Rain. It's only $5. Great book. Autopsy of a Deceased Church. He said that one of the reasons that churches die is because the past is the hero. The past is the hero. Not God. Oh, y'all better hear this. It ain't God that they love. It was back then in 2005, we had a great convocation. In 2007, we had the best church anniversary y'all ever had. And so guess what happened? The past becomes the hero. So people are so enamored about yesterday, they refuse to step into what God has for them now. Oh, I'm preaching. You must be able to move into what God has for you today without a lot of struggle. Sometimes we got to pull people kicking and streaming into what God wants to have them right now. They are still stuck on, well, the old saints did it like this. The old church did it like that. But guess what? God is still moving. And for my oldest things, don't get mad at me because I was there. I really appreciate what the old church did. I love what the old church did. But I do realize that God is still doing things. But as long as the past is the hero, we are not looking to God, who is the author and the finisher of my life. Stuck on him being the author, we'll never move to him being the finisher. So we stuck on what he did back then, but God said, I was starting the movement then. I'm trying to finish it now. Because the more you struggle with transition, the more time you're wasting. See, we like to say that we are led by God, but if we were the true church, we're led by God, it would be a vibrant place full of creativity and full of unpredictability. If you're led by God, this would be a creative place inside of you. This would be an unpredictable place. You come inside of here not knowing what God will do this Sunday. Because see, that's when you are really led by God. You see, and if we were really led by God, we would never be bored with our walk with God. Never should you get bored by walking with God. Never should you get tired and get complacent with your walk with God. Because our God is too vast. He is too magnificent to ever allow his people to be bored with him. You don't even know 1% about who I am. How you bored with me? Maybe I'm bored with you because I know every hair on your head. I know every day that you've been. I know what you're going to do. I know all that. And you think you're bored with me? You don't know enough about me. Beyonce said, you must not know about me. God said, you must not know about me. How are you bored with me? Every time I say, Lord, I'm bored with God, God said, Daniel, if you study a little bit deeper, you're going to find out some more about me. But see, if you stuck on, y'all better hear this, if you stuck on what you learned back when you were 12 years old in Sunday school, if the only God you know is what you heard last Sunday by the preacher, but you're not learning anything for yourself, y'all better hear me, then yes, you're going to be bored. But God is not like that. He is saying, the Bible says, he says, behold, I do a new thing. Y'all better hear this. That means that it's not his fault that people are bored. It's not his fault that we become stale and bored. It is just that we got satisfied with our previous level and we refuse to transition to the current time. I'm used to it. I'm not used to what they're doing right now. I'm not used to what you're doing right now, Bob. I was happy back then. So let me stay in what I was in back then. But God said, you will get bored because you're not ready to transition. So the time in the past has become our hero because we would rather stay there than go where God wants us to go. Some of y'all still sitting here and you're going to pray for 5 minutes. And you ain't never tried to go into the throne room. You never said, Lord, let me begin to lift my hands. Let me begin to take a different experience with you. I want to play some worship music while I pray to you, God. I want to, Lord, shut all the doors in my house. I want to turn everything off. I want to make sure that this is your time, God. I hear people talking about they go to the throne room. I want to go to the throne room every now and then. I want to seek your face. I want to push past the veil every now and then. They talk about the anointing. I want some anointing, God. I want to know your power, God. Can you admit that you guys sometimes you say, Lord, there has to be more than this? Yes. Yes. Because the man of God, he's passed on. His name is Archbishop Barry Nash. And one thing, he preached a sermon that whenever I get down, every time I get to preach, I go back and listen to the same sermon. He says, there's got to be more. Yes. And sometimes in the house of God, we are stuck where we are, and we're happy there. We don't want more. You better hear me. It's got to be more. So the time in the past become a hero because we don't want to go where God wants us to go. So we are quick to talk about the past move of God because we don't see a future that is greater than the past. If you don't see a future, you can only talk about the past. You ever met people who only talk about the past because they see no future? My wife, we talk on the phone. Every morning we talk on the phone and we're planning our future. I thank God for what God did in the past. But I said, baby, we can talk about the past. I don't want to talk about the present that much. I want to talk about the future. Because I see a future. Oh, y'all better hear me. I see a future. Oh, you better hear me. So your God is not just a God of the past. He's also the God of your present and of your future. And if you're willing to transition to his time, your present and your future is going to be awesome. Hekiah 2:9. I want y'all to see it. It said, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than that of the former. That means God said, what I'm doing in the future will be bigger than what I did back then. We think that God moved back then. God can move right now. God used you back then. God can use you right now. Oh, God, heal me inside of here. And in this place will I give peace to the Lord of hosts. You can stay in the past, but my God is not just stop there. He is still moving. And what is in front of me will be greater than what's behind me. And I'm going to be responsible to that time. I preach to myself if I have to, because I'm feeling good. Let me tell you something. Another point. No one has power over your time. Nobody has power over your time. You're wasting your time talking to your haters about them having power over your time. Nobody has power over your time. God promised Noah that he would never again curse the earth because of the actions of any man, right? So God is not going to punish the ground for what we do. Said, no longer I'm going to punish the ground for what man did. People are evil even in their thoughts. Can I be real inside of here? Sometimes you're going to spend a lot of time rebuking yourself. If you are truly a person of God, you're going to spend time rebuking you. We got so good at rebuking other people. We couldn't wait to rebuke somebody else. But how much do we rebuke ourselves? When some evil imagination comes in my heart, when I see my brother the wrong way, when I'm thinking evil thoughts about my sister, my brother, and I'm thinking bad about them, and they didn't say nothing to me. Or they did say something to me, they didn't even know what they said bothered you, and they're just going about their business, but you got something inside your heart talking about they should know that they did something to me. They don't know sometimes. You know what I've learned? I am only an expert on me. I'm only an expert on me. I've had to go to school to get my certification for psychology, had to sit through psychology classes. Don't I learn through all that? The only person you know pretty well, not all the way, is you. So I know me, but I don't know what you meant by what you did sometimes. And if I hold it inside my heart because you did something to me, and I think that you did something to me, and you should know better, guess what? Unless I tell you, sometimes you don't know. You just don't know. You know, have you ever had your friends and sometimes the way you kid and have fun and play around is not how they do it? You know, that's why you don't ever see something about pastors. I very seldom play with people. I very seldom. I know some pastors, they talk and they kid and they joke and they run around. I very seldom do it unless I know you really well. And I know you really, really well. I'm more introverted around people who I don't know because I don't want to say anything or do something that is going wanting to offend them. I go home sometimes saying, Lord, should I have said that? Should I have done that? And I said, Lord, because I'm the only person I know is myself. But the Bible says that the men, that their very imagination was evil. You know what that means? That means that I got to rebuke me all day sometimes. That when that evil spirit comes up inside my mind and tell me something going on that I have no evidence that's going on at all, I got to say, Lord, I rebuke that in Jesus' name. I don't know about clap on that, but that's true. Because we want to rebuke somebody else. We need to rebuke us sometimes. Because that thing grows inside your mind, doesn't it? And before you know it, it's been a week. What started out something small in your head, not nobody else's head, but in our head, it gets bigger, doesn't it? That's going to help somebody inside. So God said, I can't do that. And God said, if God curses the ground for the actions of one man, it will indirectly affect his people. Therefore, nobody can curse the thing which God wants to bless you. So stop worrying about what they are doing. If God has assigned something to bless you, that job won't bless you, it's gonna bless you. If I said that car won't bless you, it's gonna bless you. If I said that relationship gonna bless you, it's gonna bless you. There's nothing that anybody can do because they can stop what I want to bless you. Oh, y'all better shout on that. As long as there is an earth, there gonna be seasons. Somebody say seasons. As the world turns, there will still be days in our lives. There will be a sign, there will be seasons assigned by God to fulfill every purpose in our lives. I don't care who overlooks you. I don't care how many times you ignore or unnotice. As long as the earth remains, God has ordained seasons inside your life. That means that everything has an expiration date, but Jesus being with us. Everything I go through is an expiration date. The only thing that does not have an expiration date is Jesus. Because Jesus says, Lord, I'm with you always. Even until the ends of the earth. So it doesn't matter how bad or good this season is, it's going to transition to something else. So your season of advancement is on its way. Your season of trials are on their way too.